Now, for more on plastics and their alternatives, I'm joined from Burbank, California by Dianna Cohen. She's the CEO and co-founder of the Plastic Pollution Coalition. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Now, we know there tends to be a lot of finger pointing when it comes to the source of addressing plastic pollution. Manufacturers, consumer demand and disposal, and then governments not stepping in to enforce policies. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, plastic pollution is a global crisis, and we're just beginning to understand the extent to which it's impacting human health, animal health, the ocean, and the environment. And it's very important for industry and as well as governments to step up and to get involved. And companies that are making apparel, a number of them, particularly the ones that have a conscience, are working on this right now and trying to figure out what they can do so that they stop contributing to the problem and start becoming part of the solution.
And certainly in the clothing industry and beyond, we have seen a lot of initiatives, for example, getting rid of single-use plastic straws, banning or charging for plastic bags to really try and reduce plastic waste. So how effective has this been in the short term?
Well, in the short term, you can see in cities and towns and, in fact, places where they have banned plastic bags or banned plastic straws, a marked reduction in those in terms of seeing them in the environment and in the street, and also a beginning of a shift in behavior so that people begin to think about reusables instead and use materials like a reusable canvas or cloth bag or a basket, or if you like a straw, to use a steel straw or a glass straw or a bamboo straw. But people are beginning to think about how they can use things that are made out of materials that can be used over and over again many times. So it begins to shift the whole mindset towards reusables, which is really the direction that we need to go in order to protect the planet and stop creating so much plastic pollution and so much waste.
And it's one of those things where plastic, it's used so much, it's become part of the culture, from the packaging to food storage. And then we see these disturbing images of these whales washing up dead with their stomachs filled with the range of plastic that we use every day. So what are some of the better plastic alternatives out there or in the works in terms of the commercial market, really the mass-produced products?
Well, I mean, right now there are many other alternative products that are available to people. You can choose, if it's available to you, you can choose to buy things packaged in glass or packaged in natural materials. You can store things or package them in ceramics. You can also use stainless steel. Many cultures, like in India, they have a long culture of using tiffin containers to deliver and take their lunch to work with them. And we really need to cultivate that and bringing ideas like that back where we are reusing materials rather than just thinking about single use and designing with intended obsolescence. That packaging that you're describing is not only bad for the planet and bad for the ocean, but it's also, we're saying, quite bad for animals, and it's bad for us and bad for human health.
And speaking about that, tell us a little bit more about the human health impact of plastic pollution.
Sure. Well, so the chemicals that are used to make plastics, which include different groups of chemicals, but you may have heard of bisphenol A, BPA, or bisphenols, and phthalates. These are plasticizing chemicals that are added to the carbon source. These chemicals have been linked in humans to lower sexual function, sterility, infertility, to breast cancer, brain cancer, and prostate cancer, and to obesity and diabetes, of which, at least in the United States, I mean, we're having epidemics with these illnesses. So it's really important to pay attention to that. And then babies as well, exposed in utero to these chemicals like bisphenols and BPA, it's been linked to shortened anogenital distance, smaller penis size, feminization of boys, early menses in girls, and lower IQ, among other things. So it's a real cause for concern.
Now, despite some of these long-term issues, we see that for a lot of companies, it really is about the bottom line, though. So what are some of the areas or regions of the world that would struggle most financially if you did have a change like banning plastics?
Some of the areas in the world? Well, I think that plastic pollution overall is an issue that disproportionately impacts people in lower income communities, whether we're talking about across the United States or around the world, because people don't have a choice. And they're impacted by this entire industry because a lot of people don't know that plastic is primarily made from petroleum. So they're impacted by extraction and war. They're impacted by manufacturing and production. Then it when we use these materials to package all of our food and beverages in them, they're potentially toxic or impact our health in that way. And immediately they become a waste management problem and a waste issue. And many places have no infrastructure to support things, even if the packaging were recyclable. If you don't have an infrastructure that supports recycling, then that's just a moot point. So right. I think we're going to see a lot of changes along the entire system. It might impact ExxonMobil's bottom line. I don't know.
All right. Well, thank you. Lots of great insights there. Dianna Cohen, co-founder and CEO of Plastic Pollution Coalition.